Good morning, viewers. Today I'm going to do a quick review on this Seiko MarineMaster Diving Computer. This watch is sort of perhaps a niche item among collectors or perhaps real dive watch enthusiasts or real divers, in fact. It's certainly kind of the epitome of a tool watch. This watch is made by Seiko, was made by Seiko. It was originally released in 2000, and the model number is SBDK001. It was labeled the NX MarineMaster Diving Computer. This was a JDM model. It's produced for, I think, 3 or 4 years and then discontinued. So 2000s to 2000, maybe five, was its product life. It's a very unusual watch, and we'll go into a little bit why. I'm going to keep this review really short, so let me start with the dimensions. This watch measures, let me get my gauge out. This watch measures 51 millimeters across and 53 millimeters this way, 51 millimeters this way, and 16.7 millimeters thick. It has a completely flat case back, which makes it wear very broad, I guess you could say. But also because this is smooth and the screws are recessed, it is a comfortable watch to wear. At 16.7 millimeters, you notice the thickness, but it's got this sort of dome to it, and the crystal is heavily recessed, so it'll fit under cuff, assuming you want to wear it. It has 22 millimeter lug gap right here, and it uses Seiko fat spring bars, your typical, fat Seiko spring bars. A little about this watch from the construction standpoint. The watch is made entirely of grade 5 titanium. So Seiko calls it, at this point in Seiko's marketing, they call it bright titanium. It's titanium alloy. As you can see on the back, it says titanium alloy. The case back is stainless steel. The case back has these machined kind of recesses in it for these screws. The screws are also titanium alloy. And the case back is actually very thick. It's a solid plate. On the inside of the case back, it has sort of like this weird, interesting, like black coating, just like this. This coating is a DLC coating. I've confirmed that with some Seiko materials. This bezel is actually made of titanium alloy as well, and it's coated with a DLC coating. The way that the Japanese English translator described it is, it's a bonded carbide layer. So clearly that means like a DLC or some sort of a ion plating or whatever. And the rest is titanium alloy. Like I said, Seiko called it bright titanium at the time. Now Seiko uses the phrase high intensity titanium. They're all just labels for high strength titanium. Like bright is another way to say a high strength light. High intensity is also another way of saying a high strength light. Or, so they're all essentially weird kind of translation errors for high strength titanium. And like this book that I've used before, this is the Seiko dive watch book. It actually says that the titanium alloy that Seiko uses is grade 5 titanium, which is 6A04B titanium. So why did I buy this watch? Well, I'm kind of a Seiko enthusiast. I like some of these interesting watches. I got a great deal on this watch, but I don't wear it very much. It is a big watch. Like, to give you a quick size comparison, inside an already large dive watch, this is the MarineMaster 600 Spring Drive. You can see that it's bigger. Like, it's a very large watch. I mean, look at that. I mean, you could have this as your everyday wear. Like, it certainly, sorry, there's my reflection. It certainly is comfortable to wear. It's just big. And, because it's a digital, it's not really for everyone. And it kind of just looks more toolish or toyish at the same time. Let me do one more. You see that? It's a big watch. It's lightweight. Weighs 120 grams. Let me tell you a little bit of the features. Has a Hardlex crystal. You can see some scratches on the crystal a little bit. Had an anti-reflect coating that's scratched off. Has a DH33 quartz caliber. The caliber does a number of things. It has dive logging. It has dive tables. It has a pressure sensor, depth sensor right here. It has an automatic turn on. This turns on like when this is exposed to water and it conducts electricity, it will set your dive time and depth. It has all sorts of features. You would actually sit down with this, with the manual, and program your dives into it, and it has an audible alarm, and it would beep and tell you when you need to ascend or when you're depthing to descend. So when this came out in the early 2000s, most divers, as they do today, would use a dive computer. This is in fact a small kind of dive computer with sort of limited features. But I think part of the sales pitch for this watch was that most of the dive computers that were out at that time were very, like, maybe the phrase is just maybe a little too professional. They're very large. Even to this day, they're large. They're very, very big, sort of the size of like a small jewelry box. I don't have anything to compare, but there are large watches. Imagine something about 3 inches thick and 2 inches round, often made by Santo. Santo, you know, has a name for itself in the dive watch category, in the dive computer. They're frequently made of a very hard composite plastic that was water resistant, and they use screws around the perimeter. And I think the idea behind this watch is this was a little bit more versatile. And so if you were, whether you're a pro diver or whatever, you could use this and be safe, and this would accomplish a lot of the same goals and keep you safe in the water. You'll notice it's only got 100 meter water resistance, but it's a scuba diver's 100 meter water resistance. I would trust this at 100 meters over many dive watches marketed with much higher water resistance. When you pull apart the case to change the battery, you're struck by how high quality it feels. I'll link up a couple of photos. I mean, these screws have these thick, deep threads, and they go all the way into the case. They're milled directly into this titanium alloy. You can see kind of in the case gap, like where the machining tool came by and just machined away the metal with a spiral cutter. It's really kind of, I mean, if you kind of enjoy seeing like those, you know, CNC machine parts, this is definitely a CNC machine part. These screws up here are functional. These actually hold on this apparatus. If you remove this underneath it, you'll find a clamp that holds the crystal in place, and you'll find this dot, this sensor right here. When you take off the case back, you'll see this huge movement. It uses a C2023 battery, a CR2023, main Japan. It's light. Like I said, it weighs 118 grams. That's with the original strap on it. The original strap was a curved vent, which you can see here. One of the things that's interesting about this watch, and I wish Seiko would go back to, is you'll notice there's a drilled lug here and a drilled lug here, but on this side, there's no drilled lug. This was a common technique for applying drilled lugs to the early 2000s, late 1990s pro dive watches. And you'll notice the same thing on like the SBBN007, which was kind of one of the earlier, it was like the second or the third generation of MarineMaster, 300 meter tuna MarineMasters with the 7C46 movement. They had drilled lugs on one side, but not the other. And I kind of preferred it because if at least one side is drilled, then it makes it easy to change the straps. Both sides don't really need to be drilled, in my opinion. Like, for example, this one, you know, this came out 5 years after, in 2005, 5 years after this watch came out, probably right after this one was discontinued, but both sides are drilled, which is really cool because, you know, like, obviously this watch is a little bit more versatile and looks and probably a little bit more durable in terms of water resistance, but it also doesn't need to have a pressure sensor and all that. So this was the kind of watch that you would buy, like, if you were gonna actually be diving and you actually need this for your dive timing. So it does a lot of things. You can find all the reviews, like all the specs online. As you can see, this is sort of your normal screen. It shows the day of the week, the month, the day of the month, the time, the seconds. It shows whether I have an alarm set. Has an alarm. This is a light. Let me see if I can kind of see it. Light works great. This sets, this is sort of the mode. This is if you're diving with air. This is, I don't know what that is. This is a log. The logs are empty. It also will work with Nitrox, which is just a more technical kind of diving. I think this is to set it right up here. I don't actually, you know, see surface time, DSAT. I don't know how to use it. It's been fun to wear, but I kind of wear it like you might wear, say, a Santo sports watch right now if you're like jogging or something, you want something digital. It works quite well for that. I'll put the strap on in a second and show you how it's fit. I tend to like to do these reviews without the strap on because it gives me a little better ability to show you the watch. I mean, I think what strikes me, other than the fact that this is such a utilitarian dive computer, is that it feels ultra durable and trustworthy, and it kind of has a nice, interesting appeal. It's also probably one of the least expensive watches you could buy in this grade 5 titanium alloy, because right now I think the prices for brand new trend around $1,000 to say $600 for one in. This is probably maybe, I don't know what the valuation of this one would be, several hundred dollars. But, you know, like if that grade 5 titanium makes a difference to you, if it's important, or if you want to wear a watch that's made out of that, this is probably the least expensive watch you can get that'll do it. But it's also because it's so unique and not really versatile. I just think it's a cool watch. It's kind of got a cool story just because it's a actual dive watch. I bought this from a chap who was a pro diver, and he, at least according to what he tells me, he said he used it on dives. And he said there are times when he was using it and nothing else, no other dive computer, and times when he used it and had other dive computers. So I'm gonna put the strap on real quick. Okay, that one will attach this strap, give you a also something interesting is you can change the battery yourself. Like if you're in the States and you want to be able to replace the gaskets, they're a real challenge to find. I've been fortunate. I bought a replacement gasket, couple of sets actually, because they're not really that expensive. They just have to be ordered from Japan. And I got some replacement back screws because these were the screws were a little damaged when I got it from battery lasts about 3 years, I think. You see, so I mean, is it big? Yeah, it's big. Is it comfortable? It is actually. I could wear this under a shirt cuff, but people would look at me funny when they see it peek out. They would say like, wow, that's a humongous watch. And I think it's because the dial is so big. The display, you know, like I like watches that have a sweep second hand, even if it's ticking along. You may have said before that I prefer quartz movements to automatics. Spring drives are a nice hybrid. But you see how it fits, right? It's like a nice watch. It's really interesting. And for those of you who can kind of geek out about these really high-end Seiko products, this is in a way kind of nostalgia. I still remember when these first went on sale. I've been collecting for a long time, and I just remember thinking, wow, that's such an interesting watch. And they were really expensive at the time, too. I remember they cost more than a MarineMaster 300-meter automatic. At that time, the MM300, the SBDK001 was about, I think they're about $1,400 new. I can't remember the exchange rate, but that was about $1,400 new. You had to get them from Higuchi or a few of the other stores, Chino Watch, the ones that would sell online back in, you know, 99, 2000, 2001. And this one was like $1,700-$1,800. I remember thinking, holy moly, that's a lot for this watch. But at the same time, you get a Marine, you could get a Seamaster 300 barely used for $1,100, $1,200. So, you know, this, I mean, and at the same time, like a Rolex sub, like a relatively modern Rolex sub in the early 2000s, they were selling for four thousand. Brand new, they were 6,000. Used, they take like about 1,000, 2,000 hit. I mean, so this was a really expensive watch. I mean, granted, when this one came out, it was $5,000. This watch was really expensive. But now they're really, you can get them for a song. Some people love them. I've actually seen these in the wild on a trip to Southeast Asia. I saw someone, a local, at a dive shop wearing one of these, and I thought, wow, that's really cool. And I'm guessing he probably changes the batteries every 3 years, and that's his only watch. They're cool watches. I just thought I would share it. What I might do at some point is post a video of the case back off and what it looks like to change the battery, just if you geek out about that kind of stuff. Anyway, please like and subscribe. I'll try and post new content every Friday. And please consider liking and subscribing. Thanks so much for watching my channel.